No, I wasn't.
Musical sensation, Jelly's Last Jam. Great performances takes a behind-the-scenes look at the making of a landmark musical that's the hottest ticket in town.
We get to see how Jelly took in all of the rhythms, the street sounds, the African rhythms, and expressed it in his own music.
Get ready for Jammin', Jelly Roll Morton on Broadway, next. Great Performances is made possible.
Show is not so much about Jelly Roll Morton as it is about the African American people, and our history as African American people is in the music. You have to listen to the songs, the blues and jazz, to know what we've gone through in this country, because it's not in the books. You're not going to get it in school. I love working on the show, seeing the rainbow of blackness on the stage, you know, and talking about issues that are usually ignored or swept under the rug.
I think this show talks about issues that you just don't see on Broadway. People don't think that a person, that an audience wants to sit and listen about issues like race.
We need to use the stage to say things about the condition of being African-American in this country. The show is not the typical African-American show. Jelly is dark.
Sit right here,
think a thousand miles away. Since I had the blues this bad, cannot remember the day. Tell me, baby, what you got on?
I love the character so much because he really is some sort of American everyman to me. We're all like him. We all being a mutt, being a country of mutts, where nobody, being a country of mutts, you're so, everybody here is so perpetually trying to embrace some sort of purity. You know what I mean? Black Americans are trying to claim a purity to Africa. White Americans are trying to claim this purity to Europe. This is going on, whereas everybody is a mutt. We've been informed by each other's energy, and there is a strength and a power in that, but the mutt always wants to be pure. So that therefore he became, for me as a character, not just a story about a musician and not just a story about a Creole slash African American, but a story really about this American hero who suffers from, which I think is the defining tragedy of this country, which is he was a racist.
Jelly Roll Morton was a national superstar. He called himself the man who invented jazz. He was the largest selling black recording artist for RCA in 1927 and 1928. But by 1930, he was forgotten, a has-been. What happened? Jelly Roll was born Ferdinand Joseph Lament in New Orleans about 1885 into an educated middle-class Creole family. He was raised on French opera, but as a teenager, he began to explore other musical forms, the African rhythms of the New Orleans streets, the honky-tonk blues in the whorehouses of the Tenderloin. When Jelly's family discovered his adventures in the underbelly of New Orleans sporting life, he was banished forever. This rejection left Jelly in limbo. He no longer lived in the rarefied air of his Creole family. His family became the rhythm and the music found in the streets and bars, juke joints and pool halls of the African-American world of his time. But he denied his blackness. He denied his African roots. Every performer in the cast of Jelly's Last Jam is not just entertaining the audience. Each artist has a personal investment in his or her role. They also hope that the audience will not only hum the songs, but we'll remember their message.
It's Jack Water, tastes like sherry wine. Mean, sherry wine. Miss Jack Water, it tastes like sherry wine. I love that stuff. I miss the Mississippi water, tastes like turpentine.
Hot street gal, she got a black cat bone. Oh, talking about that Rampart Street gal, she got a black cat bone.
Excuse me, you're great. Hi, listen, it's absolutely great, but you're popping the peas on Rampart Street gal. Back up about 6 inches, please.
It doesn't peak and then come down. It's just sort of staying on the same level.
Turn up the singing of it?
No, Barrow House Blues. Oh, and then settle it down like that.
Okay, we're going to do it again. Keep the enthusiasm, which is great. Get more precision, please. It's a lot of words, and you're going to have to be extra careful on it.
One, two, three, four.
Rampart Street gal, she got a black cat bone. Oh, talking about that Rampart Street gal, she got a black cat bone.
Big old black cat bone.
You know that hoe did her hoodoo. Now I can't leave her alone.
What I think is significant about Jelly's Last Jam is that it acknowledges and embraces and explores the culture from which jazz music comes. And I don't know any other show that has really done that, and any other Broadway musical that has done that. They've given you, giving you the gravy and a flash of grit, so that you know there's some there, and because it's sort of fun and dangerous, but they really haven't gone inside and telling the story of Jelly, the story of jazz. You got to have grit to go with the gravy, you got to have pain to go with the song. That I think that it is those emotional ambiguities and those awful things that spark the impulse to recover, to get beyond, and that gap between the moment of pain and trying to survive is generally where I think art comes from. In that space right there, that's where art comes from. Art don't come from joy, you know what I mean? And art doesn't come from I'm in agony and pain. Art comes from that space where you're trying to figure out how to survive the moment that you just experienced. And I think so much of African American music in particular exists in that space.
Terrific. That's it. Thank you, Linda. Thank you, Mamie. Thank you, everybody.
The first take was better.
Very possibly.
As I can understand, my folks were in the city of New Orleans long before the Louisiana Purchase. And all my folks came directly from the shores from France. This crossed the world and the other world. And they landed here in a new world years ago. It seems to be all French. And as long as I can remember, those folks that never was able to speak a word in American or English. In fact, I myself was inspired by going to the French Opera House, because the fact of it was I liked to play piano.
La 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 la, la 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 la. Our skin is fair, our blood European, our wavy hair somewhere in between. Not of grit or colored green, come what may.
You agree?
Of course.
Oui.
That's the Creole way.
There was a certain sort of brutal economy in the system of slavery that was America, which was, excuse me, one drop, you black, so therefore you can be sold, so therefore let's move this along. Whereas in New Orleans, there were black people, there were Creoles of color, then there were white people, and Creoles of color were treated at one point, when the French were running it, more like white people. And then America came in and said, no, it's too complicated. There's black people and there's white people. So the jelly bean born into that, and I'm sure taught from his family, you are perceived as this thing. This is who you really are. This is who you really are. So wear who you are everywhere you go.
Good boys like to follow, fools decide to stray. But shall it be?
What we wanted to just technically show the dominant musical things that were operating at the time when Jelly was coming of age.
Mr. Keep 'em coming.
And then Jelly comes on stage and starts singing to Young Jelly and transforms the Creole song into the ragtimey song, which was the sound of the day.
You are the one,
the one.
Sun's gonna rise on
the horizon.
When the world is keeping its eyes on, the whole world is waiting to see.
There was a square in New Orleans called Congo Square.
There's a whole other world waiting outside these parlor walls.
Get your rags ready!
Congo Square was where, on Sunday, the slaves were allowed to gather. And also New Orleans is very fascinating because it was one of the few places in this country where they were allowed to keep slaves kept their drums.
Wow, wow, wow.
Yacht girls, everyone.
A lot of the Africanisms were submerged in these street cries, so that therefore it was like 10 to 10, 10 to fix, fix your 10, and all these sort of thing, all these various sounds, so that without Jelly even being aware of it, Young Jelly is learning African rhythms.
Here comes the minion!
In that scene, in the street scene, we get to see how Jelly took in all of the rhythms, the street sounds, the African rhythms, how he took it in and expressed it in his own music.
Into his musical vocabulary and in his physical vocabulary. And is the one time where he goes from this staged sort of Creole reality where his whole body is engaged, not just sitting there like this playing the piano, but by in learning these rhythms, his whole being is in challenge. It also is around the time to where he was in about 12, 13, 14, so he was going through puberty. So it is an awakening in many respects of a beginning of an awakening of his manhood. So that the manhood is being awakening while these rhythms are being awakening, while he's learning syncopation, while in reality, Jelly Roll Morton would never admit it probably, but he's learning his Africanisms.
In my younger days, I was brought in to the Tenderloin District by friends. New Orleans was a stomping ground, we'll say, for all the greatest pianists in the country. The reason for that, they had so many mansions, sporting houses. Well, after 4 o'clock in the morning, all the girls that could get out of the houses, they were there. And everyone was just like one big happy family.
I'm gonna wear ostrich plumes and satin, a horsehair wig 3 feet high.
Chimney Man is based on a voodoo character called Baron Samedi. Baron Samedi traditionally is a liaison between this life and the next life. He sweeps people from one life, and he's traditionally pictured in the top hat and tails with a chimney sweeping broom and a cigar, really. I don't have the cigar. I liken the Chimney Man. Chimney Man is like what Shakespeare calls that sour ferryman that poets write of that leads one into the kingdom of perpetual night.
So the Chimney Man sort of in many respects became the doorway into how to work on this piece and not have it be. And then I wrote, and then I died, and I, you know, so in terms of the, it follows, this happens, and then this happens, and then this happens, but within the context of this is your night, Jelly, to relive and recreate that which was, for us to jam, Jelly. So it became not as much a trial, so much as a confrontation with self, self being the Chimney Man, Chimney Man being the blackness, which he cannot embrace about himself, is embodied in the form. So it became like this Jelly confronting himself.
You shouldn't have done that.
Oh, I know. It's your life and you want to tell it your way. But in telling the story of Jelly, the story of jazz, you got to have grit to go with the gravy. You got to have pain to go with the song.
Tu n'es pas Creole. You are not Creole. You've been lying with dirt. You are not Creole. That's why I'm telling you. You have no family. Now go.
Please.
Go.
Please.
When I went to Memphis, I went there with a fellow from Jackson, Mississippi. So he says, I tell you what we do. You play piano very well. We can always get plenty to eat. Immediately, I started to play piano.
I'll show you how to play like folks down New Orleans way. Show you the stylish fingers they had.
We decided to take the simplest Morton tune we could find, which was Salty Dog, and illustrate how it was turned into jazz, how Morton's style evolved, what constituted Morton's jazz.
Now, in order to get going, what I like to call Sweet Papa Jelly's Jazz, I need a low-down foundation. Can you help me?
Bo.
It all puts it together in that one moment, and that's how you jazz. So the syncopation, the blues, all the elements that he has been learning up to that point in the show sort of coalesce in this one moment. There's also sort of this little backwoods place where, once again, these black people have to go into a little small room to fully manifest their power. And that by Jelly coming in and teaching them jazz or how to jazz, it transforms their whole physical being as well, so that therefore it's not just a music, but it's an elixir of the soul.
Time I was considered the best dresser. Of course, my people always had me wearing diamonds since I guess I was just a baby. And I always had some kind of a diamond on, and they just figured I was a smart kid.
Record deal with RCA. Turn out 6 hit tunes a day. Don't let nobody get in your way. Doing the Chicago stomp.
Them boys in the recording studio didn't know what hit them. And I let them know I was the instigator.
Yes.
The procreator. The high tone imaginator. A J-A-double-Z. When I laid down how I come up with the tonal variations, the shifts in syncopation, yet letting the melodic structure fly, they was too through.
I know they were.
Know what I told them?
What?
I said, play it the way I wrote it. Get out.
Jelly Roll was very good at jazzing. And I think the reason that he felt that he invented it was because he did two things. He jazzed a lot better than the people that were around. He also wrote down some of the things that he jazzed. And as he wrote them down, did much as we do today. He wrote down the thematics and expected the people that he hired to apply their jazz to what he wrote down. Now, his jazz that he got, his was derived already from the existing literature around. So therefore, he decided, in my head, I think he decided that because he could do that, that he invented jazz.
Put some new suits on your back, buy a big new Cadillac. Tell the world your ass ain't black. Doing the Chicago Star.
Nolan's born and bred.
Yes, yes, New
but
Orleans.
But see, what most folks
born
don't seem to understand
bread.
Is that my ancestors
yes.
came directly,
yes.
directly,
directly yes.
from the shores
yes,
of France.
Shores of France.
And ain't no coon
yes, no.
stock in this Creole.
Oh.
That's right.
He was a racist, and unquestionably his music is black. So that was the thing which I found so incredibly attractive about the character, is that on one level, he says, I'm not this thing, but at the same time, he was fully embodying this thing and celebrating it and living it. And I thought, this is just so completely, because he does what all of us do. Generally, the things that we deny most is what we really are. And I just find that so incredibly compelling and so totally human, and I think in an incredible way, so extraordinarily American.
They say that loving is a low down blues. You ain't got nothing but your life to lose. When you can't stop yourself from loving, loving is a low down blues.
I ain't never met a woman quite like you. Ain't you gonna say you never met a man quite like me? Oh, now, Nita, come on now. Now, it's common knowledge. Now, can't nobody roll like the roll.
Sugar, haven't you heard? Men who talk about how good they are generally aren't. Ooh, ooh. Well, generally they aren't, but occasionally they are.